I'm Kat Chaos.
And I'm Liz Gomez, also known as Hazy.
And you're listening to Scary Encounters with Hazy Chaos,
a podcast where we talk to some of our favorite bands and artists
as they share scary encounters they've experienced and live to tell. This episode of Scary Encounters is brought to you by
Anchor, podcasting made easy. Anchor.fm.
Mortis Viventi, the last authentic music brand dedicated to helping musicians and promoting music. MortisViventi.com.
H.J. Tidy, Night Terror Publishing. Step into the bizarre world of H.J. Tidy, who is committed to introducing his readers to some of the most unusual, darker variety of true stories. NightTerrorPub.com.
Sayasha Gianna, cosmic shaman, psychic medium, multidimensional healer, animal whisperer, teacher of empaths, healers, and starseeds. Are your encounters hitting too close to home? Contact Sayasha Gianna. Patreon.com/Sayasha.
Voided, spooky artist who offers hand-painted one-of-a-kind items, spooky pins, prints, stickers, and more. Lost in a void of what is dead. Voided.com.
Hello out there. This is John Massari, composer of Killer Klowns from Outer Space. You are listening to Scary Encounters with Hazy Chaos.
Hey, I'm Kat Chaos.
And I'm Hazy.
And we are here with John Massari of Killer Klowns from Outer Space, music composer. That's what we were talking about, John. We have a live audience here.
Wow. I would have done my hair.
Me too.
We're so stoked to have you here today. Thank you for making time.
Thank you for having me at your lovely abode.
This is a really big deal for us. And we have the beautiful Aimee, your beautiful wife, over here in the corner. She's not on the mic because she's shy. But you're beautiful. We're happy you're here.
And she has better stories than mine.
No, stop it.
Well, I've heard a lot of good stories from both of you so far.
Yeah.
We didn't even start recording from that beginning. So.
Right? We've been bullshitting for, what, 2 hours now?
Just cracking up.
Having a good-ass time, right?
Talking Dexter.
Right? Anyways, no, really, this is a really big deal for us. It's an honor to have you here in our little Hazy Chaos Cave. For the people listening, who is John Massari? What do you do? What have you done?
I am a composer. I make music for the media industry, and I've been doing it for quite a while. And I discovered music when I was a very, very little boy. I used to commandeer the family stereo and record player and play it at all hours of the day and night, point where my parents finally got me my own radio at age 4, stuck it in my room, and I would just stare at it and listen to music constantly. And music has always given me an experience. And I had experienced really wonderful movie exhibitions and screenings where the music was a very integral part of the movie. And that spoke to me. And little by little, I started picking notes on the piano. And by the time I was 11 years old, I would say to my parents, I think I want to be a music writer. I didn't know it was an actual job, but I want to write music. And they had no idea what that was. And I said, well, you realize that when you watch TV and all, you hear music behind it. Someone makes that. Mm-hmm. And then later on, I found out it's an actual profession. So that's where it started. And I started playing in the high school band. I played trumpet. I played the contrabass. Some other brass instruments like French horn and the euphonium and percussion instruments. And I picked up the bass guitar and I played in a band called Crisis.
Oh.
From age maybe 15, 16 to 17, 18. And that's where I wrote the Killer Klowns from Outer Space theme.
No way.
Although I didn't know it was the Killer Klowns from Outer Space theme. I just thought, this is a really cool riff.
You know, what?
Don't. And you can interject it here.
Yeah, right.
And play it. And so I was, you know, I thought they would just totally go for it, and they started playing it, and one of the lead guitar players, his name was Doug, and he said, "Gosh, wait a minute, that outline's an F major 7 chord. That's a jazz chord. We don't play jazz, John. We played hard rock." This is before heavy metal, the term heavy metal existed, and so they thought it was too jazzy. So years and years later, when I sat down for the screening of Killer Klowns from Outer Space to be in consideration to be one of the composers, I go, that is it. I will get that theme. It'll work perfectly. And that's exactly what the filmmakers tuned in on. They said, with that motif, you've kind of like boiled it all down. You've defined what it is. Mm-hmm. When the scene where the clowns are marching on the town.
Yeah.
So that's what I am. I make music. I've been making music all my life, and I have music that plays everywhere, all sorts of music. I love horror. I love metal. I love classical music. I love all kinds of quirky media music that I've done. I've done a lot of commercials. And I just discovered, along with Aimee, discovered the fan base about 5 years ago. I had no idea that most of the cast and filmmakers were going to all these conventions. And there were fans that loved the movie this much. I knew that the movie was playing because I would get statements and remuneration. But I had no idea that people were just absolutely in love with the film.
Correct.
So I had no idea. So we got invited quite by accident to a convention. And I had no idea what it was all about. One of the production people from the Kyoto Brothers studio. The Kyoto Brothers are the filmmakers. Mm-hmm. The Kyoto Brothers are the three brothers that grew up all their lives as young kids loving monster movies. And they finally got an opportunity to make a movie. And they make the movie that they want to make. It's like capturing lightning in a bottle.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, who would have thought of such a crazy concept?
Right.
And it comes from the three minds of... three boys from the Bronx, New York, that grew up watching, you know, monster movies and Mighty Joe Young and King Kong.
Oh,
and,
my gosh.
And this is the movie they want to make. And so I had to think about it for a minute. I says, you want me to come where to do what? He says, we're doing a convention. It's at Monsterpalooza. I go, what the hell is Monsterpalooza? It's a convention where all the fans from Killer Klowns and other horror movies are going to go. And you can sell stuff. Like a what? Like old clothes? I don't understand. No, you can sign things. Like you can have some of your music or something that you can sign for the people. So I got there and there's a table and it's a routine. It's a racket. Mm-hmm. You know, people are signing things and cash is being handed back and forth. And they were really angry at me because I wasn't charging anything.
Ah.
I said, well, I don't know. What do you want to pay for this thing? $10 for this? We mimeographed some of the score manuscript. So I signed things. But what struck me the most is how many people love this movie.
Right.
And they truly love it. It's like a life experience for it. And it's like they're meeting me like, oh, my goodness, I have to tell you, I love the music and that theme I love. And there's this magical section. And they seem to be more... attuned to the music than I was. So I had to reacquaint myself with the movie again.
Oh my gosh.
So I had to figure out a way, how am I going to communicate with the fans with some value? You know, like have it be, you know, do I just want to appear places and sell, you know, sign autographs, or do I want to do something? So I came up with a music program about 4 years ago where I licensed the movie and licensed the right to exhibit the movie while I transposed my synthesizer score to an orchestra and conducted the orchestra live to film. And it went very well. It was at the Montauban Theater in downtown LA. We had a 1,000-seat theater, and it was absolutely fun. It was just like, just jubilant. Everyone was just thrilled to pieces. So since then, I've been trying to figure out other musical events to involve the fans with. So because I can't make another sequel. I don't have that power. Yeah. However, I do with the powers that be with MGM and Amazon. I can ask, you know, I would like to put on an event and play the music and maybe have some images from the film. So we're going to be doing a Killer Klowns cosplay dance party. So we'll see how that works out. I think it's going to be fun. It's, you know, the idea's gotten a lot of support from exhibitors. So we're going to see how that goes. But that's basically John Massari in a nutshell.
And so, that's it, ladies and gentlemen. I'm just kidding. Thank you. I'm kidding. That was just amazing. I was waiting for the crowd because
I know.
Amazing. Congratulations on all the success. I feel like the movie, I mean, it's a classic.
Mm-hmm.
It really is. And I feel like in the last year or two or a couple years, it's really come back to life, kind of, you know, resurrected, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
And everyone has an experience now that they have children and grandchildren.
Yeah.
They kind of pass it down to them.
Yeah.
And I'm just curious if it, you don't have to tell me, but what's your experience with that, this particular crazy movie?
Oh, honestly, I went a long time and I had never seen it. I knew what it was. Mm-hmm. I knew the characters. I knew it looked badass, but I had never seen it. And up until, I want to say within the last, year and a half, maybe?
Like 2 years.
2 years. Say, yeah. I was like, why have I never seen this? I love horror. I think it came out in 88, right? Right. But I remember thinking, and I like clowns. A lot of people don't, but they're cool. They look cool in the movie. So I was like, we need to watch this.
Yeah, it was interesting for sure.
And we sat on that couch that you're on right now and we put it on. We were like, all right, the music sounds really dope. These costumes are amazing. The masks, the makeup, everything, the spaceship.
Yeah, I had a good time.
It was a good time.
So you both saw it together.
Together,
for the first time.
Yeah. We did.
That's really awesome.
We did.
Yeah. Did you have popcorn?
We sure did.
Actually, yes.
Did you have like anything else, like pizza,
cotton candy?
You know what? I'm a little weird. I don't know. I like putting hot sauce on my popcorn. I don't know if anybody else.
No,
does
it's
that,
good.
But
okay.
Oh, you're getting in detail. Huh?
I know.
And I remember we were just like, oh my god, it was so fun. It was strange, yeah. And it was weird, and it was fun, and it was just so entertaining.
That came from the minds of three little boys,
exactly,
basically, that were adults.
Exactly. And honestly, it's just a classic, and people are like, it's so cheesy. I'm like, that's what makes it amazing. Like, it's just so
like 80s
horror.
Right.
Come on, you know? I love it. I love it.
And when you think of all the creative elements that went into it,
yeah,
there are more than like what I even know.
Yeah,
you know, there's a lot of personal episodes from the Chiodo brothers, uh-huh. Like characters in the Killer Klowns movie are modeled after people that they actually know.
Ah,
you know, so it's like the Mike character, the guy with the dark hair,
uh-huh.
Right? Everything about him is modeled after a friend of theirs that they went to high school with.
That's cool.
Because they figure, let's just transpose these. And that's what makes characters special, mm-hmm. What makes writing special. When you can take something from that comes from you that's mm-hmm. unique,
yeah.
And you can express it, you know, in the medium
it's
of
personal.
This story, I honestly think audiences pick up on it.
Yeah.
They have to.
They can relate to it.
That's how you get attached to certain characters.
Yeah.
Right.
So,
you can relate to them. I feel like I relate to Shorty. A lot,
mm-hmm.
For more reasons than one. I'm just kidding.
Right.
Spike is actually, I think he might be my favorite, because he's like the punk rock clown, you know, with his Liberty spikes.
And then Rudy is the cutest and smartest of all the clowns.
I mean.
Oh, I relate to that one.
Yeah.
No, but that movie, it's just a classic, and everyone knows what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Whether you like it or not, you know what it is, and that's when we applaud the makers mm-hmm. because it's
created a community.
Yeah, mm-hmm. literally. And the Killer Klowns community is huge. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's crazy. We were talking about our little friend, Creepy Cute Jayla.
Oh, yes.
Right before we started recording. Shout out to you, dear, and John and Rika and everybody.
Shout out to Jayla.
Right?
The ultimate Shorty.
Exactly. Her little cosplay of Shorty is just on point.
All her cosplays.
We have a friend that's that teaches psychology at a university in San Diego. I'm not going to say which one, but in any event, she, we had a conversation, her and I, of how people associate their personality with characters in horror, and particularly with the Shorty character.
Mm-hmm.
This is someone that's being backed into a corner And, you know, you've reached my limit. Now I come out punching.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's like a metaphor.
Right.
You know, I have this little, this cute little bike I want to show you, and all you can do is destroy it.
Right.
You know, well, I can't take it anymore.
I'm going to beat your ass.
Yeah.
Right.
Exactly.
I feel like Shorty's a Scorpio, to be honest. I'm just kidding. No,
and
I'm
I've had people confide in with me that I identify with Shorty because all my life people, I create little things and they just tear it apart. Oh, and I can't take it anymore. I just, well, you gotta stop hanging around those people.
Agreed. Like we were talking about earlier, some people just don't benefit your life or your lifestyle, and you got to just cut the cord.
I think what most creative people don't understand is that, everyone's experienced this, so I'll share my experience. You'll have a great idea, you know. And Stan Lee talks about this, the man behind Marvel. Yes, Stan Lee. He says, if you got a good idea, try to make it happen. And you may change it along the way. And it may be a success and it may fail. But at least you did it. And don't listen. Don't let some dumbass talk you out of it.
I mean, all the haters. It's so true.
Yeah. Right. I mean, I'll be very honest. I'm not going to mention names. But when I came up with the concept of doing this live concert to film, people said, really? Are you sure you're going to do that? Or aren't you going to get in trouble from MGM? I go, well, I don't think so because I just signed a contract with them.
Yeah.
And I just paid them a licensing fee. So I don't think they're going to be upset with me. Right. And then some people go, oh, it sounds pretty crazy. I go, but crazy.
That's the point.
Is what people want to see.
Yeah.
You know? And it wasn't until we had our first rehearsal that certain people were going, oh, I get it.
All of a sudden, huh?
Yeah. And I stacked the deck. I had, there's a fellow by the name of Noah Gladstone. He's not only an incredible musician, but he's a contractor. He contracts event concerts for like Riot Games and Blizzard Entertainment, all kinds of big gaming companies. And he does classical concerts, all sorts of stuff. And when you're going to do something, you want to go to the people who specialize in what you're trying to achieve. You know, it may cost you a little extra, but you want it to turn out right. So I told him what I wanted to do. We had breakfast, and he's smiling and shaking his head. Yeah, yeah, that's going to be cool.
Yeah,
let's do that. And so, and then when he says it's cool, all the musicians that he works with, they're on board as well. So I had a full orchestra of people that wanted it to happen the right way. They put their they're all first of all top called AAA level musicians. And when we did our first rehearsal, I had to tell everyone, did you guys play this concert before? Because everything was just sounding so beautiful. Yeah. Everything was in place. And I had a friend of mine in Vienna help me finish all the orchestration properly. And everything just went so well. But it wasn't until then that everyone says, okay, I like it now.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And I tell some people, like they said, you'll find out, like, you have a great idea. And people say, well, that sounds really hard. I go, well, you don't have to do it.
Right?
All you have to do is come when it's done. I'll show you when it's done, you know. And you have to have a little bit of a thick skin. You have
definitely.
You know, and you can't let people's negative opinion of you affect you. Quincy Jones said, Quincy Jones, who's a music producer, produced Michael Jackson's albums. He says, there's not one thing that you can say about me negatively that will change, you know, what I want to do. You know, I mean, unless it's like good advice.
You know?
It's like, well, the orchestra, Quincy, they called him QQ. The orchestra is going to be out of town that day. So we got to get another. That's different. That's logistics.
Yeah.
Right. Being negative is, well, you run into negative people.
Oh, all the time.
Yeah, I run into all my life. All my life. I mean, people that I know and love, I'll play music that I did. And I just want to share it with them. I don't want I don't want any accolades. And they'll say, well, it's good, I guess, but I wouldn't know. Tell me that's not a backhanded compliment.
It's crazy because I feel like as you get older, you learn how to handle these negative people and the negative opinions and all that, you know, like
your skin gets tougher.
Yeah. Because you have no choice, especially as a creative person. Mm-hmm. You're always going to have ideas and there's always going to be at least one person that's going to question it.
It's fine. Your work isn't for everyone. Yeah. You know?
Oh, and I realize there's not everyone in the world is going to love Killer Klowns from Outer Space, but the large population of people who love Killer Klowns from Outer Space will like to come to one of my events.
Right.
Because there hasn't been a new movie yet.
Right.
Well, we can go to Massari's music event.
Yeah.
And have fun and dress up like Shorty and Rudy and, you know, Clownzilla and all the characters. And no one's going to be upset with us.
Yeah.
No one's going to be scared. We'll be among our people.
Exactly.
We actually saw that at the last show we've ended at, or that was with Comic-Con. Sorry, what was the show before?
That's where we saw him.
Yeah, exactly.
Where was that?
It was in the LA Art District.
Oh, my goodness. Hold on. Too Cute to Spook.
Oh, yeah.
Killer Klown Art Show. What was it called? I'm so sorry.
It was downtown LA.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. We vended our artwork there, and that's where you signed. It was so funny because.
That's right. I signed the one that had like the yellow and red thing shooting.
Yeah.
I remember that.
Yeah, I drew Shorty.
And, did you come with like other people besides yourself?
Well, we vended, but we brought like a whole little clan with us just to support the.
Okay.
The event.
I remember now.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a good time.
Yeah, it was fun.
Yeah, I love it. And when little kids come up and talk, because little kids don't, you know, listen, people in the media industry, some of them are very introverted.
Oh, yeah.
And sometimes they don't relate to kids or parents or something like that. And I'm kind of a family man. So it's like, I'm just happy to talk to the kids and the mom and everything. And then there are people that like, it's like they get up the nerve to say, I'm going to go to school to study to be a fill in the blank.
Yeah.
Maybe a filmmaker, an animator, or maybe they're going to be going to some sort of science. And, you know, and when you tell them, that sounds incredible. Where are you going? Are you going there? Oh, that's a beautiful campus. You know, and I've had people just cry because it's the first time they've heard someone give them it's a rare occasion when someone gives them an acknowledgement,
of what they're
trying to achieve.
That's good. It's good to
be supportive.
Yes, and supported.
And supported.
Sheesh, it's true.
Thank God for the social media.
Yeah.
Well, it's a double-edged sword.
It is.
I mean, there's a lot of haters, but at the same time, there's a lot of people that will. I mean, I can't believe it. There was something I posted, and someone trolled me. And I thought it was just funny.
What's their name?
I forgot.
An address.
I forgot.
Social security.
You don't want to fuck with this,
we're coming
okay?
But all the other people on the conversation just like dog piled on them.
But you see, there's always that one.
And I just don't respond to them. Friends of mine that are YouTubers, they'll say, people can say negative stuff all they want, but when they start picking on the other people's comments, then they get banned.
Yeah.
You know.
Blocked and all that. Because you can rate this podcast on Apple Podcasts.
Oh, nice.
And we've had a 5-star rating since we started. And I recently looked, just out of curiosity, and we were at like 4.9 or something. And I was like, okay. And somebody rated us 1-star. And I was thinking, there's always that one, though. You know,
You just need it. The life is a bell curve.
Yeah.
Let's put it that way.
You're going to
have one end, you know, you have a line going up. And it's like zero people that just can't stand it, right?
Yeah.
And then you have the curve that goes way up at the top, people that live their lives for what you do, and then everything in between, and then it goes back down.
Yeah.
It's just the way it is.
It is, and it's all right. At first, I was like, what the fuck? Let me try to find out who that was. But then I was like, it's bound to happen, you know?
She put her hair up, took her
I put my hair
off.
Up. You know what
I'm
I mean?
Just kidding.
I did. Look at Aimee's cracking up, because you know, huh?
No, yeah, it happens. I mean,
it does. It's okay.
I mean, amongst fellow filmmakers, a couple of years ago, I worked on a Western.
Ooh.
You know, it was a low budget Western, but I pretended like it was like a big budgeted Western. I had a big blown out score, and some of the production people were saying, you know, you're scoring a different movie. I go, no, I'm not. I'm scoring this movie because I get to own this music afterwards and I'm doing something with it.
Ah.
So you're paying me to do something that's going to benefit me. So don't tell me to dumb it down.
Yeah.
I'm going to make this sound as legitimate as possible.
That's a great mindset.
Yeah, it has your name on it.
And then I'd say stuff like, hey, did you see that movie Bone Tomahawk? That horror Western movie? And like some people say, oh my God, that was so bizarre. I didn't even know what that was. I saw it. I don't believe I saw it. I had to watch it again. Okay, that's one end. Okay. And the complete opposite. What a piece of crap.
Really?
That's the most awful thing in the world. Why would anyone want to bother? That's like an insult to Western. And they just didn't get it. Well, apparently it's not for you.
Yeah.
You know? And that happens with that happened with Killer Klowns. After I did recording and the movie was out, I wanted to do a special mix of the, so I got the master tapes back and remixed everything. And I delivered it back to the studio like a month later. And I was on the this was when it was a different company. It was called Transworld Entertainment, not MGM. It's Transworld Entertainment. And they're not, I don't believe they're in business anymore. But there were guys from the accounting and legal department with me on the elevator. So I had this dolly with all these 2-inch, 24 tracks stacked on top of each other. There were 10 of them, right? Right. And then they said, what's that for? Oh, it's one of your products. It's Killer Klowns from Outer Space. Oh, that thing's a piece of crap.
Aw.
You can throw that. You should just throw it. Why are you bringing it back? You should just throw it in the dumpster.
No.
That movie's going to die so fast. Everyone's going to forget about that movie. In 10 years, nobody's going to want to know that even existed.
Wow.
And my response to them was, well, this movie isn't for you.
Yeah. Simple as that. Yeah. And here we are. Just like earlier, I said, I feel like it's resurrected.
Right.
It's like back. And
right.
It's just so fun. It's a good time.
So, but when are we going to talk about the paranormal?
You know, look at him. He's ready, huh? Well, before we get into that, mm-hmm. we did send you two questions.
Yes.
Yes. So let's get into those really quick.
I actually have thought about it.
First question. If you...
Is there a sound effect? First question is, tick-tock, tick-tock.
You know what? I'll add that next time.
I know. We should add it, right?
Something.
First question. If you can bring back any celebrity from the dead for a day, who would you choose and why?
It would be Rita Hayworth.
Tell us more.
Okay. Rita Hayworth was not only very beautiful, she was very talented. And not many people know this, but she was an ethnic European known as a Romani, a gypsy.
Okay.
Right? And she was very talented as a young girl, and she worked with her father. This was like a generation of people that says, the kid has a talent, I need to exploit it. So they worked like in entertainment, like doing carnivals and magic shows and stuff like that. And he was very abusive to her. And that abuse from people followed her into her professional career. The only one person she was married to that treated her nice was Orson Welles, but they weren't married for very long. Orson Welles is very famous filmmaker. He did the classic Citizen Kane, classic movie, and a classic filmmaker. And he regrets that he didn't appreciate her more and have a longer relationship with her. And then she married someone else who was also basically saw her as a property, not as a wife. And so, anyways, I would just want to bring her back so that she can just chill and do her art and not be, if I was going to white knight someone, that would be Rita Hayworth.
Aww.
So that's that.
She can just relax and enjoy herself.
Well, she can relax, enjoy herself, and do her thing without being abused.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, without any hindrance.
That's great.
How did she
selfless.
Die?
Selfless, yes. How did she die?
She died rather young. I think she had, and she died in the 80s. She died in the 80s. I think she was in her late 60s, and she had some sort of Alzheimer's, I believe. Yeah.
Oh.
She died way too young.
Definitely. Yeah. She sounds like an amazing woman, though.
Yeah, very beautiful.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Going to have to look her up after. We'll post a picture in the recap.
There was a kind of look. There was Rita Hayworth, and then there was Jean Tierney.
Okay.
Probably never heard of her.
No.
Yeah, she did tons of movies in the 40s and 50s. And Jean Tierney was also a girlfriend of... JFK. Along with Marilyn Monroe.
Yeah. That's the one everyone knows, right?
Yes.
Sheesh. Well, thank you for that.
Sure.
That was a good one. Mm-hmm.
That's a good answer.
Yeah. Let's go on to our second question.
All right. So question number two. If you were on death row or on your deathbed, what would you choose as your last meal?
Can I not be on death row?
No.
It's so funny. Some people are like, well, if I'm on death row, I probably did this. So it's probably, like, oh, shit.
Probably, if you've done something bad enough where you've got to be put down, maybe you shouldn't be having anything to eat.
I mean, you're right.
Well,
or if you're wrongly accused.
If I was on death row, it'd be for being the female Dexter.
Oh, shit. No shit, dude.
Well, isn't the character Hannibal Lecter someone who kills people who are evil? Right?
No. I don't think so.
Hannibal
Lecter. Are we wrong?
Hannibal Lecter, cuz I thought what he got put, the backstory is he got put in prison for life for killing someone who was a major pedophile.
Really?
And there was a court, or he was a psychiatrist, right? That had a court order to analyze him. And in analyzing him, he gave him some drugs, and he convinced the person, the pedophile,
yeah,
to disfigure himself
with a knife
because he's under the influence of because a psychiatrist, yeah, you know, has access to all kinds of drugs. Yeah. They're a doctor. They can actually operate on you. You know, yeah, they go to medical school. So
yeah.
So that's when I saw that was in the second one. Not the Silence of the Lambs, because we never knew what he was in.
We kind of didn't, huh? They never really explained it.
Not in the first one, yeah. So there's the backstory. And then there's the one that goes back into his history.
Yeah.
Like, he actually had a very good relationship with his mother and father, but it was events during the war and surviving during the war and shortly after the war, World War II we're talking about, that sculpted his need to...
Kill.
Yeah.
It's been a while interesting. Since I've seen that, but yeah.
Liz, what you just said is so accurate, though. I can't see you go to jail for anything else other than being the female Dexter.
The way, thank you.
Dextera, if you will.
Dexterina.
Dexterina.
Okay, I would make a very provincial Italian dish.
Okay.
Wait, did you say you would make it?
I would make it.
Okay.
If I was in death row, if I was about to die, mm-hmm, well, or I would instruct someone. Not on death row, but if I was on my deathbed. And it's a very simple dish. It's with ham hocks, tomato sauce cooked for a long time, and then you add white cannellini beans to that. And maybe you have, with the tomato sauce from that, you would use that with your pasta, and that would be your bean and meat dish, and then a salad.
Wow.
That sounds pretty good.
That sounds simple but good.
We made that for someone. We did a fundraiser, and one of the, you know, if someone participated at a certain level, they come to my house and I will make them a meal. And
that, so that's amazing. The meal I made to them.
It's a meal. It's something you can only eat once every 2 years.
Oh, really?
Because it's like 8,000 calories.
Oh, a million calories.
Well, with that attitude,
shit.
Well,
challenge accepted.
Right? Don't tempt us with a good time.
No, that sounds amazing. What would you have to drink with that?
Ooh.
Oh, a very rugged red wine.
I don't know how I knew you were going to say that, but I didn't know rugged, but I knew you were going to say
pasta,
red wine.
Right? I can
see
okay.
that. Yeah. That sounds good. Yeah. Simple, but good.
Okay.
It sounds filling.
Let's go out.
Let's go to dinner. Now let's get into the paranormal,
yes, please.
Okay. And the spooky shit. Whenever you're ready, whatever you want to start with.
Well, I don't know if it's spooky, but it's bizarre.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I happen to believe that there were so many people there. I think there's a massive population in the world that has been through trying times, and they have basically PTSD from it that goes untreated, and they just pass it to other people. It just like perpetuates. But we'll just stick with World War II. People come back from World War II, the soldiers come back, and they're really not treated for all the trauma that they experienced. And they go through their entire lives. Some people can cope with, you know, with trauma and tragedy and say, okay, that's over and that's behind me. I'm going to move ahead. Other people, it's part of their daily lives,
yeah,
you know. And So I think my relatives, specifically my dad, who grew up as a boy, grew up in Italy in World War II, just growing up being used to having, you know, towns and buildings blown up and having moving to one blown out building to another over a period of time. And you have brief respites of calm where there's nothing going on, you know, and you have something of a normal, quote unquote, normal family life. And he had him and his five sisters. And so after the war, he came to the United States. He was in the Korean War in the Navy. And then he got married. And so it's like you think everything's behind him, right? So we get into the 1960s, and paraphrasing everything. So we get to the 1960s, and we have something called the Cuban Missile Crisis. I don't know if you're familiar with that. Okay, I actually, as a five-year-old, heard John F. Kennedy say that if Russia does not remove missiles from Cuba, it will be considered an attack on the United States, and if they land there, we will respond with an attack on the Soviet Union, period. So don't put your missiles there. All of a sudden, where you thought there was an empty field, there were missiles all of a sudden that were above ground. And it was like three blocks from our house. It turned out to be, I have the data here, and you guys can check this out for me. Everyone listening can look on the, I got to put my glasses on. Here we are.
There we go.
Okay. So there was a network of Nike missile bases. There was one in El Monte, South El Monte.
Oh.
It was called LA-14. One in Puente Hills, Brea area.
Right here.
Yes. LA-29.
Wow.
Right? The one that was near my house was LA-32. And they were operational between 1956 and 1974. And Nike is the goddess of victory.
Okay.
Right? So these were anti-ballistic missiles. So that if there was missiles incoming to the United States, these missiles supposedly can be deployed and knock out incoming missiles.
That's crazy.
So these were all over the place. So me as a kid, I kind of think like, oh, well, those are going to go to the moon. Those are spaceships. You know,
oh, yeah.
You know, romanticizing.
So innocent, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, because not too long after that, and they were up for a year, always out and exposed, because what would happen is that they would go down under the ground and be stored somewhere. Well, in that location right now is the one that was near my house in Garden Grove was turned into a water reservoir because they had all that. You know, it was all dug out, mm-hmm. right? And there's a sports park on top of it, soccer fields, baseball fields. Growing up in that, there's like an innocence. You think it's like for space exploration, but it's actually literally part of the Cold War. And it's so funny because I would tell people this and they would kind of look at me funny. I go, maybe it was my imagination. Maybe as a kid being romanticizing yeah. about it. Maybe we went to an air show or something like yeah. that. And maybe I'm putting it together. So I looked it up, and where do you go when you look up things? You go to YouTube.
Yeah.
So I punch in Nike missile bases in Southern California. Mm-hmm. And there's a couple that has a video channel called, I think, Oddity Adventures. Adventures in Oddity or something like that. Mm-hmm. And they went and visited them all.
Wow.
The place, this is where.
It was all the places you just named.
They didn't go to all of them. They didn't go to mine, but they went to the ones that are, you see some of the components are still sort of there. The missiles aren't there.
That's
but
scary.
Like, but like maybe the launch pads are still yeah. there and they're just like rotting.
Right in your backyard, right?
Yeah.
That's nuts. Yeah.
And this is where during the Vietnam War, when an aircraft carrier comes in, it doesn't come in with all the planes on it. Like maybe 200 or 300 miles out, all the planes will fly off to land at this Air Force, at this Naval Air Station. But jets were constantly coming over. I remember being in kindergarten. We'd just sit on the grass and look. We have an air show because they would fly over the school.
Yeah.
And you could fly relatively slow and low. And sometimes we could see, you know, I guess because our eyes were really good, we could see the pilots inside.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And they never waved at us. We would wave at them. But and then when they would deploy, they would go out and you would hear sonic booms because they would, you know,
take off,
kick it. You know, once they take off and then they're going to go out to the ship, maybe they're testing everything, making sure everything works. But you would hear boom.
Yeah.
Have you ever heard sonic booms?
Not in person, no.
They are intimidating. Well, I used to have mining property in the desert, and every once in a while you would see they would be it would be near Edwards Air Force Base. So they're doing maneuvers, all sorts of stuff. There's all kinds of aircraft flying around. They're practicing refueling. They're doing low-level flying. They're giant B-52s flying super low and then coming up fast. And, you know, they're just practicing because it's out in the middle of nowhere. There's no one out there.
Yeah.
But when you see a fighter jet coming at you and you cannot hear it, that's a sign you have to plug your ears really quick. Because once it passes you, it's going faster than the speed of sound. So when we were kids, we would grow up hearing like 20 of those sometimes in a day. Kaboom, kaboom, kaboom. Because they would fly up and go fast. Like when the space shuttle comes back down, sometimes you may have heard it when the space, sometimes you can feel the space shuttle sonic boom. So we grew up with that sort of stuff. Yeah. And there were sometimes when I guess because I was a little kid, and I'm talking about like 6 or 7 years old, I would hear like a really low, long tone, like just not thunder. Mm-hmm. I knew the difference between thunder and whatever this sound was. And like I said, this may be my romanticizing about it, but now when I think about it as an adult and I would read up on it, when they were doing above ground testing with atomic bombs way in Nevada and in New Mexico, they say seismographs could pick up the vibrations as far as like 300, 400, 500 miles away. Mm-hmm. And sometimes the sound waves will go clear halfway around the world. They're detectable. I guess they did tests that could pick them up. So maybe as a little kid, you know, your sensitive ears are more sensitive. And I picked up these low frequencies. I'm guessing maybe that's what it was. Maybe it wasn't, you know. So, so anyways, back to trauma. So you have family members that, like, will just be angry at something. You can't figure out why they're so angry, you know. And I will confess, I do have a level of PTSD. If someone's in my blind spot and I don't know they're there and they all of a sudden they show up, I have to, like, really control myself because my first
instinct,
my first reaction, I've learned to respond rather than to react. Because early in my early 20s, I mean, I would throw a phone at someone and they're not attacking me, but it's like, it's just, I go, wait, why is that? And then I realized through counseling, I realized, well, you've been around with so many people that have been through so many wars. And I would say, well, sometimes I would just look at my dad a certain way and he'd be like so pissed at me, like he's about to kill me, you know. And he goes, I don't know, I would have to sit your dad down. I mean, by this time, my dad had passed away. But, you know, it's like you've inherited whatever that was, you know. And they used to tell me stories like they would really worry about, like, if it was really windy and or raining, like heavy weather, they go, because that's when troops move. When the heavy, so they can, the sound of all the equipment is not going to be heard. And so they always saw that, like, rain and thunder and heavy snow, any heavy, severe weather is a bad omen because that means troops are going to be moving around, right? Mm-hmm. So that was kind of scary. That's not paranormal, though.
No, I feel like it's, you're saying PTSD is like mental health type of thing.
Right.
Which is also something that, you know, needs to be talked about because a lot of people don't. I'm sure somebody, at least one person listening right now can relate to you.
Mm-hmm.
And the whole throwing a phone at you.
Right.
Well, there's a bunch of trauma that can be inherited.
Well, I would say there's someone here that's experienced that.
Me?
No, Aimee. Oh.
Oh, Aimee.
I mean, I'll be working at my computer. Really?
You threw a phone at her?
No, I didn't throw a phone at her.
I was about to throw my phone at
you. I'll show you exactly what I do. What is that? And I tell her, just knock at the door as you're coming up the stairs.
Yeah.
Tell me.
Yeah.
You know? And so, like, I'll be working, and all of a sudden, out of my blind spot, there's a plate of food coming in. And I don't know. It's just like something that was there I didn't expect. And I just, what? Why did you do that?
I'm kind of like that too, huh?
Yeah.
You're very
I'm very jumpy. Dramatic like that, and I jump, and I just, I do, huh?
Yeah.
But
yeah.
At least you're acknowledging it, and you're...
Yeah. Now she says, I'm coming upstairs. I'm going to be over here. I'm right behind you, like if we're in the kitchen, right behind you opening up the door.
Yeah.
Now it's like you're over
here. I'm breathing.
I'm alive. So, okay.
Thank
so
you for sharing that, though. Well, no.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
Very interesting.
So here's the paranormal thing.
Okay.
I was 9 or 10. Mm-hmm. Watching. Okay, so you have to understand, this is the time where you can't just watch anything you want anytime you want. Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. So after school, I would come home around 3:30, and at 4 o'clock they would play cartoons from 4 to 5. Okay. From 4 o'clock to 5 o'clock in the afternoon. That's like sacred time.
Oh yeah.
And then the news comes on, that's when I do my homework. So one day I was in our den. We had a coffee table, and I would lie on that coffee table, and I was just watching my cartoons, just like so thrilled. You know, Bugs Bunny.
Yeah.
You know, and then there was, all the great Hanna-Barbera stuff. There was Augie Doggy and Snaggletooth the Tiger and all.
Snaggletooth. Yeah, I like Snaggletooth.
All kinds of crazy stuff, right?
Yogi Bear.
And all of a sudden, out of nowhere. Mm-hmm. Massive earthquake.
Oh, no.
The whole room is shaking. Whoa, that's a big one. And I'm just like, okay, it's over. And then I noticed something really odd. Uh-huh. Very odd. More odd than the earthquake.
Okay.
My mom not screaming. Because every time there was an earthquake, she was very triggered. Mm-hmm. She goes, oh, my God, let's get out of the house. She'd be screaming at the top of her lungs. Oh, my God. It's very panic.
Yeah.
Very panic prone. Uh-huh. To the point it was like, listen, this earthquake isn't so bad compared to you panicking, screaming and yelling. And I go over, maybe she's not in the house. Maybe she's next door. I go in. She's in the kitchen. She's like putting some together for dinner. Did we just have an earthquake? And she goes, what? I think we just had an earthquake. No? I don't feel anything.
Oh, wow.
So that was bizarre. So that was it.
That's unexplained.
The only thing I can't explain. I was fully awake, you know, and I was just thinking, you know, because the windows, and it was just like a big chkajoom.
Huh. So did anything fall or break?
There was nothing on the walls or anything like that to break. It was just like the windows shook.
Okay.
And I could feel the house jerk. I've experienced earthquakes before in that house. Mm-hmm. And it has a certain sound. You know, you hear the frame of the house going moving. And nothing. And I had no explanation for it.
What could have that been?
I don't know. I'm trying to think, but.
And you obviously weren't dreaming. You were awake.
No, I was fully awake. No, I have, you know, sometimes you're asleep. And then all of a sudden you feel like you're falling, like when you're asleep, even in bed, right? It wasn't that. It was an actual boom. I'm looking around and I'm seeing, hearing the window almost like a, you know, how you would take a sheet metal and go, whoa, 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 back. It was almost kind of something like that with the window.
Weird.
And things shaking.
Maybe it was aliens.
Maybe.
Maybe they were coming.
Maybe. Who knows?
Maybe it was the killer clowns from outer space.
Maybe. They were finally landing.
Right? It was Shorty.
They planted the seed in your head as far as for their theme song.
Hey.
Right.
You never know.
Wait, question. How old were you when you wrote that? When that first came to you?
15, 16, I think, right?
I was like out of 15 going into 16.
Okay. Yeah. Cool.
That's so cool. Yeah. Crisis
was the band.
That's so cool. Very cool.
Spelled regularly.
Regular. Not with a K, with a Z.
Yeah. That would have been cool.
Right? Let's start a new band.
That would make sense.
Crisis with a K.
Wow, well, that's crazy. I don't know. I'm trying to, like, think about
it. I'm trying to debunk it here, but you were a kid, so obviously you weren't on anything and you weren't drunk. Mm-mm. Okay.
That wasn't until I was 11. And then I couldn't drink. I couldn't even smell alcohol 11? Without getting completely sick.
11?
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Well, everyone, my parents used to have parties and everyone seemed so happy.
Yeah.
So I'm going to try that. So I went over and I poured a little bit of everything into a glass. I went into my room and gulped it down.
No, you didn't.
I'm going, oh, this isn't. And I go, no. I was, head was spinning for like a day and a half.
We call that jungle juice.
We call that jungle juice.
Oh, God, no.
So I was sick as a dog. And if I even smelled alcohol.
That's crazy.
So I wasn't drunk. That was after.
That was after. Oh, okay. A year after.
Yeah.
I wonder, I mean, I would love to hear any ideas or thoughts, opinions on this story.
Anybody listening, and if you have some type of debunk for this story.
Or if you've experienced something similar, let us know.
If you thought there was an earthquake and nobody else felt it, what the heck?
I mean, I thought of like sometimes like the water heater. You know, but we didn't have a water heater attached to the house. It was detached from the house.
It wouldn't be enough to make the windows move like that either.
Yeah.
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 Weird. I wonder if you'll ever get an answer to that.
I'm going to say aliens. I think I like that better.
Do you, what do you feel about aliens? ETs, UFOs.
Well, you know, the one movie I saw that really, Arrival.
Is that the one?
Did you see the movie Arrival?
With,
I forgot her name, but she plays Lois Lane in one of the Superman movies.
Who's in that?
Oh, I forgot.
What's the one we saw with Nicolas Cage?
Oh, that's Knowing. I love that one.
Knowing.
Oh, Knowing. Wasn't that one where they find a capsule, time capsule?
Yes.
Yeah, that's and, the one. And it has all these predictions and these numbers.
That was awesome. Together.
That was a lot of fun. You might see, here's my arm standing up.
Really?
Yeah, it's so creepy. Such a it creepy
is. It is creepy.
Creepy idea.
It's so good.
Here's my opinion. It's like I just saw a podcast about SETI, and all the things that we're talking about SETI, and you know, we've only been doing SETI for so many years, so those radio waves are only going to go out so far. They have to go out for another 50,000 years, maybe, and if someone is able to figure out what it is that we're saying, it's going to take another 50,000 years to answer. Yeah. And then I was thinking to myself, well, maybe radio waves is such a rudimental way of communicating. It's almost like, let's say, people in Spain or in Portugal. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's say in Portugal, says, we don't know if there's anyone on the other side of the ocean. We're going to make a big sign miles across. We're going to hope maybe they can read it. Maybe they'll put up a big sign on the other
side.
On their side. And we'll, you know what I mean? Maybe that's what radio waves are like.
Yeah.
Like that's, it's just like so many physicists say to think that we can go to another world with a chemical rocket burning chemical fuel. It's got to be a completely different way of traveling that we haven't figured out yet.
Yeah.
I mean, at some point. It will be. It's theoretical now, but maybe it'll be commonplace at some point. I love that movie Contact.
Never seen it.
Yeah, you got to see Contact.
Okay. Have you seen it, Liz?
It's been a while.
Yeah. So you know what SETI is, right? The search for extraterrestrial intelligence. They're continually sending I don't even know if it's still funded, but they're sending radio waves and then listening to radio waves to see if they're hearing some kind of
signal
that sounds like it might be from an intelligent source.
Interesting,
So is it possible? I'm sure.
Yeah.
And then you think how incredible would it be is like this whole universe, which is vast beyond our imagination, and it took all of that to create what we have here on Earth.
Yeah.
You know, and what are we doing? We're like fighting over stupid crap.
Stupid shit, huh?
Right. When you think of all the, you know, you see the stuff on TV, all the things people arguing about and all the hating and all the crazy stuff, people making fun of each other, all the crazy political stuff. And then if you took, you know, perspective and you looked from space, even 10,000 miles.
They're laughing at us right now.
10,000 miles from space, looking at this beautiful little blue marble with this like little tiny film of air on it. And you just realize, you live on paradise.
Yeah.
Would you just get over it and chill?
Get over it and get along.
You've been born, you're alive, yeah. And you're so lucky to be breathing, and then you're wasting your time with all this crap.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
That reminds me of a meme that I saw not too long ago. It's like a drawing of two aliens flying by Earth. They're like, wow, this planet's really ghetto. Put your windows up.
Put your windows up.
That is hilarious.
I mean, it's...
That is so funny.
It's so good. It's accurate, though. Like, Earth is ghetto. Like, that's crazy. We are firm believers in this home of extraterrestrials. Mm-hmm. That's for sure. Have you seen our painting over there in the corner? That is...
I love that one. That is beautiful.
My extended family.
Mm-hmm. Family portrait.
Family portrait.
But yeah, that was actually done by one of our...
This one here with the...
Yeah, that one, yeah, with you.
That is a beautiful piece.
He's all, wait, family portrait? It's a painting by our friend Area 90.
He got that custom made when we first...
Custom made to match the paint on the walls. It's a UFO abduction in a forest. It's really cool. We'll post a picture of it in your recap video, recap photos. Mm-hmm. But yeah, one of our favorite artists. It's really cool. But yeah, so it's just crazy. This... we always say it, and we respect everyone's opinions. If they don't believe in it, okay, that's fine. Mm-hmm. But this universe is just so large. Like, how are we the only living beings on this whole... it's just, I don't know. It's just
life
crazy.
Is very resilient. Life, even in the most unsuspecting places here on Earth, you think that there would be no life. There's something is thriving. So it's postulated that on some of the moons of Saturn and Jupiter, where there's more water on those moons than there is on the whole planet Earth.
Wow.
That's crazy,
and
right?
There's, you know, because of the tidal forces, the way they orbit around these large planets, they're being pulled and moved. And, you know, it's almost like there are tides that may be warming it up enough where life could thrive. And when you think of all the life that's on Earth that we haven't even discovered.
Right.
That we can't even see with our own eyes.
Yes.
Or in the ocean. Isn't it like 90-something percent that we haven't discovered?
Absolutely.
I honestly think aliens are in the sky. They're in underground. They're in the ocean. Mm-hmm. They're everywhere. Mm-hmm. That's my opinion.
Sitting next to me.
I'm right here, you know? But the ocean is very scary. It freaks me out.
Yeah, me too.
Did you see the Netflix movie Don't Look Up?
No, not yet.
Oh, you gotta see it.
I've seen.
I won't say anything, but the last line of the movie, that one of the scientists says, is so perfect. It's really? Leonardo DiCaprio has the best line in the whole movie.
And Jennifer Lawrence, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, we've been wanting to watch that.
Oh, that's the one.
That's the one.
That's it. You would make... I bet you guys could do a good reaction. Are you able to do reaction videos?
We've never done one before.
I think that takes that's a certain kind of groove you have to be in to do reaction video. You know, you're showing the... you've got a split screen, you're watching a movie, and it has you reacting to it. And I've seen those. Some of them are hilarious, but they don't show the whole movie. They cut it up
to go
to the best part.
They edit it.
You know, people have always requested us to make a YouTube channel because they want to see us.
Mm-hmm. But I usually break cameras.
And honestly, we're so camera shy. We don't like we'll take selfies all day, but we can't be on video. It's just fun. It's just weird.
That's why they have masks.
That's why we have masks. But we're always like, just hear our voices. This is enough. That's why we start a podcast with no... video.
If you're happy with that,
but Aimee just gave us a thumbs up, so maybe we should do it because I like Aimee. maybe one day though,
well, start little by little,
right?
Do it like
reaction video.
A reaction maybe to a scene.
There you go.
And
I'm really dramatic.
Let's say it's let's say it's a movie that everyone's seen.
Yeah.
And you don't want to get in trouble with YouTube, it's like, let's say it's from Jaws.
Yeah.
And let's say. Like, you've seen Jaws before, right?
Yes.
Okay, like the scene where they said, he says, we're going to need a bigger boat, right?
Yeah.
So you guys can do, like, you know, focus on those punchlines.
Yeah.
And look at each other and go, oh, my God, whatever.
Right? All dramatic, huh?
So your first movies could be, like, first videos could be, like, 3 minutes long.
Yeah.
And you do, like, 10 of them. See what kind of response you get.
It's a good idea. I mean, we've been getting this request for a while now, and... we're always turning it down and being like, our voices are good enough. Like, we just, we're really bratty about it, but maybe one day we should do it.
Yeah, I'm very camera shy.
Maybe just good lighting, like good lighting maybe.
You wouldn't just jump in a cold pool. Sometimes you feel around.
You put your big toe in first,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah, see how it feels.
Yeah. You know what? Oh, man, I wish that we were recording our reaction when we watched Hereditary.
Ooh.
Have you seen Hereditary?
Oh.
Oh.
It just released?
And you like horror?
That's, mm-hmm. It's been out for a while. It has a...
Ooh, I don't even want to...
Is it a science experiment?
What's her... No. Okay.
Toni
Collette.
She's in it.
Do you know her? Mm-hmm. She's amazing in it. I don't even want to give you a gist of the movie.
We will watch that tonight, sweetheart.
Oh,
Hereditary. We'll watch that tonight. Yeah.
But if we had a reaction video to that one scene that I won't mention, but everybody who's listening
There's
knows...
There's a few scenes. I was like, oh...
No, but
we were in the movies and everyone just like got quiet. Like,
oh. Everybody, all you heard was a.
Oh, you went to see it in the movie.
We saw it in the theater. It was before pandemic, so it's a few years old.
Oh, so we could probably stream it.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Yeah. Definitely.
It should be on like Amazon Prime.
But I'll never forget the feeling in the theater for this one scene in particular.
Yeah.
You just didn't see it coming. And when it happened, everybody went, and then it just got completely silent and nobody knew what to do with themselves.
I was like, what did
I know I
watch?
Didn't. I know I didn't. But that would have been a good reaction video.
There, I had binged on a bunch of horror movies that I was backlogged on.
Yeah.
I literally forgot every single title.
Oh, really?
Yeah. There's one. Okay. I bet you I can describe the movie.
Okay.
If
let's
seen
see.
It,
let's see.
And you know the title.
Okay.
Okay. So... People move into a new house.
Da-da-da. I'm just kidding. Imagine.
Okay. And it's seemingly, a benign house.
Okay.
And the dad finds a box, and it's got 8mm film in it. Okay. And he's looking at the film. And it's like film of his family moving in.
What?
Yeah. And then all of a sudden, you'll see some weird figure in the backyard or something like that.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, he's like... addicted to watching it, but he doesn't share it with the rest of his family.
Huh.
And crazy things start happening. His kids start waking up and walking around, and then he finds out that he's hearing noises in the attic. Mm-hmm. He goes up into the attic and he finds more film.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
It's okay, really, we haven't seen that one.
Yeah.
That sounds like, I want to say Sinister.
That is Sinister.
Yeah, right?
Thank you very much.
Yay, we won. Good job, Liz.
Yeah.
Scored by my friend, my pal, Christopher Young.
You said scored? Cool.
Scored, yeah. Christopher Young. I went to school with Christopher Young.
Shout out to Christopher. That's awesome. Yeah. Sinister.
Yeah.
Dang, like, good job. I know this one. That was great.
And I don't know if they've made a sequel to it.
I don't think so. Yeah. Or I haven't heard of it.
And it has such a mean ending.
Ugh.
It's mean. It's not. It doesn't have a good ending.
I don't remember the ending.
Yeah, everything's mean.
It's been mean.
Everything's
mean. I need to watch it. I need to watch it.
That's why I think horror movies will not go over well in India, because there's good guy, bad guy, and the good guy wins at the end.
Always, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so you probably won't remember the name, but I'm going to ask you, what's your favorite horror movie of all time? If you don't remember the name, you can describe it.
I don't have one.
No?
I can tell you what my first one was.
What's your first? Exorcist?
Absolutely terrified me. Well, yeah, The Exorcist terrified me.
Yeah.
Because it's so Catholic.
Oh, yeah. Right.
And I felt so bad for that little girl. And it's like, and the music is absolutely perfect because the music was written years before.
Yeah. Okay. Right?
And Mike Oldfield. Who still does music, still puts out albums.
Very cool.
And that music is like innocent and beautiful.
Yeah.
When you think of it. And it works perfectly because basically it's the innocence of the little girl that's like encapsulated in her whole body. She can't get out. She's being possessed. And that's what makes that music work so well. But the movie that terrified me for the first time, I saw probably in 19... Don't freak out.
Okay.
I saw it in 1969 or 1970.
Nice.
Okay. The movie was made in 63, so it was showing on TV. My parents watched it, and I watched it with them. It was called The Haunting.
The Haunting.
Yes. Scared the absolute everything out of me.
Have you seen it, Aimee? No.
No. It's black and white. And It's a haunted house movie, uh-huh. right? So it takes place in a haunted house, and I'm not going to go through the storyline. You just watch the movie, and
okay.
people will agree with me. It was yeah. pretty scary for its time. It was terrifying. So I could not sleep.
Nice.
I was awake, literally, like with my eyes open, waiting to see the sunrise.
Oh man!
And my window looked out to the east, right? And I lived in a little town called La Palma, and they had not yet built any other homes. So there was this chicken farm next to us. So I had a clear shot at the, you know, Saddleback Mountain and all the mountains way out there.
So you, yeah.
And so I was waiting for, I literally would stand there awake waiting for the sun to come up. And when the sun didn't come up, I felt, oh, God, that's good.
No, I can't sleep. So
I think it's great when movies do that.
Yeah.
I'd be creeped out know. If I'm walking by your house and you're staring out your window at night, just like.
I'm waiting for the sun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The Strangers did that to me because it was
The Stranger.
Have you seen that one?
No, I probably have. I won't get into it,
but it's about a home invasion. It's a home invasion movie.
Wait a minute, is that with Keanu Reeves? No.
With Liv Tyler.
Strangers, haven't seen that. I gotta see that.
It's very good. It's very. They do everything you would do in the situation. It's very realistic because mm-hmm. you know how in some movies it's like, just do this, duh, but they never do it.
Right.
Well, in this movie, they do it, and it, you know. I'm not going to say no more, but that movie just really got me because everything I was like, just do this. They did it and it wasn't working.
Right.
And it was just something as simple as a home invasion. It wasn't paranormal. Mm-hmm. It wasn't demonic. It wasn't.
That's terrifying.
Yeah. And I remember for a while I was like, fuck, like I need someone to walk me out to my car. Like you just never know because it can happen to literally anybody.
Right. You have to be vigilant.
You have to be aware of your surroundings at all times because it can happen to anybody. But yeah, that's a really good one, The Strangers.
There was a movie with Keanu Reeves that Aimee and I watched that was absolutely terrifying, where a husband who had this idyllic family, and they went away and for like, you know, a week, and these two girls come up to the house.
Oh.
I forgot what that's called, but that was so terrifying.
What's that?
Wait, with Keanu Reeves.
Liz, yes. You're on a roll.
Yeah.
No, oh, yes. I know which one. This one's more of a newer one.
It was on Netflix.
It was on Netflix.
Yes.
That one was crazy.
It's called Crazy?
No, that one was crazy.
That was crazy. And
Let me see.
I discovered that it was a remake of a movie made in the 70s.
Oh, wow.
And I want to see the movie that was made in the 70s. But it's only on VHS, and it's hard to find a copy. It was never released in any format, and I think people like managed to make copies of it.
Okay.
Just when VHS was available, mm-hmm. but it was never distributed by a company. It's not on DVD. It doesn't like stream. Digital. And you can find little scenes of it. And people that have seen the original one say both of them are great. Hmm. They're just different.
It's called Knock Knock.
Yes.
And it came out in 2015.
Yes.
It says two stranded women reveal a sinister agenda after they spend the night with a married architect who played by Keanu Reeves. Yes,
Kiki right.
Ree. Kiki Ree, yes. That movie was a trip. We were pissed, remember?
Yeah.
Because he was like, at first we were like, come on, Keanu. Like, okay. Why are you opening the door?
Aimee is a witness to this.
Uh-oh.
I go, the Uber guy is at the door, out of my house. That's it. Out of here.
Right?
I don't know. You know what? I'm very wary of someone who's all of a sudden out of nowhere is very attracted to me and wants to hang around me. You're up to something. Sorry.
Aimee, he's on to you.
Just kidding.
I mean, yeah.
Eight years later.
And the whole time. And it's like there are some times where she knows I'm the worst. I'll sit there and yell at the screen.
Yeah, yeah.
Like an old grandpa yelling at the wrestlers on professional wrestling.
Yes, you know? WWF.
Yeah. I mean, my grandfather used to watch wrestling.
Mine too.
And he used to hit the TV when the guy was, look, he's coming from behind.
Right? Turn around, right?
I wish I had a video at that time.
I know.
Because that was so funny.
At least you have the memories, right?
But I'd be screaming at him. He says, you know, the girls show up. I go, no, no, no. Just stay right there. He'll give you a towel.
Right.
Let me call the taxi for it. He's here in 5 minutes.
Because it was raining, right?
Yeah, you ain't fucking coming to my house. Because in my imagination, You are keeping my attention while someone else is trying to break in my exactly. back door.
Because they're two pretty young girls.
Yeah.
And he was just trying to be a nice guy, but at the same time, it's like, no, Keanu, don't.
Oh, and that's a typical street thing where some girl will talk to you, and all of a sudden, you know, there's a guy there's going to knock you on the head and steal, you know, whatever, rob you, right? And so I would be so pissed. Suspicious. And I was yelling at him, like like the character's going to listen to me.
I know, right?
What do you think, John? Oh, okay, let me just make sure the Uber guy comes here faster. And so that...
Hey, that makes it
By the way,
fun.
I love Canal Reef.
I mean, you never know. Maybe this next time around, they will listen to you.
You never imagine that?
I feel that way with whenever I watch Selena.
Oh, shit.
I know how it's going to end.
Oh, the movie.
We always want it to end differently, but it never does.
Don't trust her.
You know what? Quentin Tarantino needs to make a movie about Selena where she doesn't get killed.
Why do you say Quentin, though?
Because he did... Hollywoodland.
You're right.
Where Sharon Tate didn't get killed, and the two guys next door kill the Manson family that comes over to kill the people next door to them.
Spoiler alert.
Yeah. Oops.
Oh, I mean, that was great. Hey, well, Quentin, if you're listening right now.
I'm a huge fan.
You heard it from John himself. You need to make a movie about Selena.
Okay, now I'm gonna get a lot of hate for this, but I want to ask you, if Selena was still with us today, what do you think J Lo's career would have been like?
Oh, non-existent.
Okay.
I agree.
Okay, you're here.
You know what?
You saw.
You know what?
It's right here.
Yeah, let me say
something.
That
last song that she did with her dad, that her dad produced. It was like so 70s slow jam. It was like one of her last singles that she did.
Selena, which one?
No, J-Lo. J-Lo or,
no,
or
no,
Selena?
Selena.
Oh, Dreaming of You.
Yes.
Don't make me sing it. Yeah, it was with her brother.
Please don't make her.
I'm just kidding, bitch. You said you didn't like that song?
I love that song.
You love that song.
That's such a good song.
I mean, because it's like they just nailed the early and mid 70s slow jam sound.
It's beautiful.
You know, and it was done in the 90s or in the late 80s?
90s.
Yeah. It was done in the 90s.
Honestly, I've always said this. And you know what? I have love for J-Lo.
Yeah.
She's awesome.
Definitely.
However, her career would not be what it is today without Selena.
Right.
I mean, we'll never know.
No, but I know.
How about that scene, though, when she's doing the lip thing while she's singing that song?
Oh, like this?
Yeah, something like that.
Like that?
Who's doing
perfect
that?
J-Lo.
No. It has to be Selena.
We'll send it to you later.
Sorry.
No, but yeah, that is a movie that we always wish for a different ending for. Mm-hmm. And don't trust her, fucking Yolanda. I can't stand Yolanda. Oh my God.
Is Yolanda in prison?
Oh yeah, she's rotting. But she's supposed to be released in 2025.
No.
Yes. And we're
so she didn't get the death penalty.
No. She's supposed to be released soon, and me and Liz will be there, ready.
Text Arena.
You and like the entire five states of people.
I mean, she has no way in hell. I'd want to stay in prison if I were her, because honestly, this is a death
where
threat.
Where would she go?
Edit that out.
Where would she go?
Honestly.
When she's out of prison.
Honestly, she's going to get taken care of, is what I'm going to say.
I don't think she's getting out.
I don't think she will.
You think they're going to have her parole meeting and say, oh, no, you're not ready to come out?
No, I'm saying she's going to get killed if she comes out.
Right.
I said taken care of because I don't want to be so dark, but.
Well, there's a lot of, I don't know, people are.
Okay, people listening right now.
I don't know how they would handle that situation.
What do you think will happen if Yolanda Saldivar?
Yeah, I think so.
Irrelevant. I don't care what her name is. What do you think will happen if she gets released from prison tomorrow? What do you think will happen?
Well,
please
I'm
leave
sure
a comment.
I'm sure they're going to want to like hide her
there'll
identity.
There'll be giant contingency.
Huge
of
riot.
Fans.
Huge riot. Everybody's going to attack, and we'll be there. Anyways, how did we get into this? My God.
Where am I?
Who am I?
Okay, I want to know why Criminal Minds has no new episodes.
Oh.
They left me hanging.
Did they?
I haven't seen the show.
How about the new Criminal Minds? How about the new Unsolved Mysteries? Did you watch those?
No.
Those are fun.
John?
I have work to do. There's only so much I can watch. My brain will turn to jello if I watch too much TV.
Join us. Join the jello crew.
Multitask. Play it in the background.
Right, Aimee?
Well, I do. Someone says you have to see Look Up. And so I put it on my cell phone and kind of watch it out of the corner of my eye. And then I told Aimee, we've got to watch this together. I know I missed a bunch of stuff. I got the whole gist of the story.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of little... I mean, you know, I'm working on something, playing music in earbuds and then hearing a movie play at the same time, which is kind of cool. Sometimes I do that. Yeah. Sometimes I listen to podcasts and what have you
while I'm working. Scary Encounters? I'm just kidding. With Hazy Chaos?
Yes. Oh, yeah. I listened to yours while I was working.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, the one you did about the Turnbow Canyon.
Turnbull.
All the fascinating things, they go back to
it's crazy,
like the 1880s as well. Mm-hmm. You know, there was that guy who he made a big a purchase of property, and he was celebrating, and
he was drunk.
Yeah, and he was drunk, taking his horse back.
Yeah,
why?
Good
his
job.
Horse?
Yeah,
because they didn't have cars.
They didn't,
Mr. Turnbull.
Yeah,
crazy, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. Shout out to Nicolette. She does her research really well for these episodes. She's the singer of Go Betty Go, a really well-known punk, all-female punk band here in LA.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, so she's joined us the last two seasons, and she does little, like, history lessons like that. So season three, she did Griffith Park, which was really interesting.
I bet.
Next season, we're taking requests, though, for what people want to hear, because they requested Turnbull Canyon. So I gotta
listen to the Griffith Park one.
Yeah, I'll send you the link. It's actually really interesting. We learned a lot, right?
I've hiked so much in Griffith Park, so it'd be interesting to hear all the
very interesting
all the goings on. There's a place I want to visit again. It's called the Wisdom Tree up there, and it's imagine you're on the road above the Hollywood sign, and you keep going west on the trail, you'll run into the Wisdom Tree. People leave their journals there.
Aww.
Or they'll make little, like, rock sculptures. But the first time I went there, like, a week before, I had seen the Blair Witch Project.
Oh.
So I'm thinking, oh, my gosh, is there, like, some kind of weird cult
witchcraft
up here?
Shit.
Witchcraft stuff up here. And then I didn't realize that was the Wisdom Tree.
Ah, we should go visit.
Yeah.
Sounds fun.
That'd be fun.
So it's a bit of a hike.
Okay, you know, I will go.
There's two ways to get there. There's a long way, and then there's a shorter. There's a shorter long way.
Okay,
but it's kind of like you want to go when it's chilly.
Oh yeah.
You don't want to go during when it's like during summer where it's hot.
Like
and
I
sunny.
Said, I'll admit I'm dramatic. I'll make her take a wagon and pull me in the wagon.
I was like, we're just gonna Uber up there.
Make sure the Uber driver's waiting.
Or you can get one of those scooters, those heavy-duty off-road scooters.
That sounds good.
It'll take you up there.
Knowing me, I'll fall off, though. Off the cliff.
She's so
is
drama.
There a cliff?
Anyway.
No, it's a trail. You'll roll.
I'll roll.
And stop at some point.
Okay, that sounds all right.
There's a lot of brush
That sounds
there.
Decent.
That sounds like great content for the show. Scary Encounter, I rolled off the cliff or whatever, you know.
And then only you go on with the podcast and I'll be here in spirit?
I'll tell your story.
You're going to tell me the story?
I got you.
With that being said, John,
yes.
This was so much fun.
It's over?
It's over? Unless you have more to share with us.
I thought we just started.
Look at that, an hour and a half ago. It doesn't go by so quick when you're having a good time.
You guys are mean.
No, we can keep going, John. We can keep going.
It's the eyebrows.
Because you know what? I know. Everybody thinks we're mean. It's the eyebrows for sure. I told Aimee, hey, I put my eyebrows on for you guys, so.
She did. That's a commitment.
Right? Both of us did.
That is a commitment. Well, I shaved extra close, and I trimmed my beard with my trimmer thingy.
So you did good, too, today.
Yeah, we did.
Wow.
And Aimee wore her thingy.
You know what? You guys walked in, and I saw you guys walking up. I said, oh, my God. They are badass looking.
Looking all fierce, dressing all black.
All black.
Our kind of people.
You guys just look really good together. You guys are very beautiful together.
Well, this has been a lot of fun. It's really refreshing.
Yeah.
To be with two people that you're not only a very important part of the horror community and have an appreciation for it, but you also are creative people yourself. You create music yourself.
Yeah.
So to be interviewed, to sit here with two musicians and not talk about music for an hour and a half. It's kind of refreshing.
Aww,
it's actually really cool, you know.
That was really cool. Yeah. That was fun.
Yeah, it's always fun. I mean, we can always look up different interviews on different bands and see their history. You know, that's always right. like a... People always want to know those things, but how mm-hmm. often do you get to ask some of your favorite bands or artists about their ghost experiences or any near-death experiences?
Or their last meals right. if they were on yeah. death row. What yeah. the fuck?
You just
right?
don't get those kind of questions, and I love that topic already.
At some point, we'll come back, and I'll give you the near-death. Yeah.
We would love to do a part two with you.
Sure, sure.
We can talk about everything you're doing. I mean, it sounds like you have some things planned. The mm-hmm. dance party.
Yes, so, in May.
And we'll be there.
At Zombie Joe's Underground Theater, we're going to have 4 nights of the Killer Klowns from Outer Space cosplay dance party.
So cool.
Yeah, it's going to be really nice.
That's so cool.
We want to capture the kind of energy that they had at the Scare Zone in Orlando, Florida.
Okay.
And all the jubilant celebration of just dancing around and having fun.
Yeah.
You know, dressed like Killer Klowns.
I think that's what people need right now, man. Like,
yeah.
I feel like the last couple of years have been so shitty.
Yeah.
So people need to go out. Good vibes and Killer Klowns and dancing.
Right.
That sounds good.
Right.
That's going to make a sign.
And I've been creating all new tracks.
There you go.
Yeah. And there are some other things happening in the summer around Halloween.
Mm.
And, but I'll announce those later.
On part two of this.
I'll put you in the loop.
Okay.
Sounds
on
good.
On that. Yeah.
All right.
And next year, I'm looking forward to doing some events as well.
Cool. Definitely. All right, John and great. Aimee, it was a pleasure yes. talking with you guys and just hanging out. I feel like you said, this was very refreshing.
Yes.
We can and talk I need about to hear music
your,
now.
I need to hear I need to hear your music at some yeah. point. So you gotta get me links to your stuff. So
definitely.
You know, I can steal.
I'll show you a little clip right now.
Oh yeah. We actually have just steal. a little snippet that we've never
Sure. You're going to show it or?
No.
No,
nobody.
When
no.
we're off the air. Yes.
Off the air. Nobody okay. knows about
gotcha.
This.
Gotcha.
But anyways, John, thank you so much for joining us. Thank you for your time.
You guys are very awesome.
Yes.
Thank you.
And until next time, have a good night.
And be scary.
Yes.
Exactly. This episode of Scary Encounters is brought to you by
Anchor, podcasting made easy. Anchor.fm.
Mortis Viventi. The last authentic music brand dedicated to helping musicians and promoting music. MortisViventi.com.
HJ Tidy, Night Terror Publishing. Step into the bizarre world of HJ Tidy, who is committed to introducing his readers to some of the most unusual, darker variety of true stories. NightTerrorPub.com.
Sayasha Gianna, cosmic shaman, psychic medium, multidimensional healer, animal whisperer, teacher of empaths, healers, and starseeds. Are your encounters hitting too close to home? Contact Sayasha Gianna, patreon.com/Sayasha.
Voided, spooky artist who offers hand-painted one-of-a-kind items, spooky pins, prints, stickers, and more. Lost in a void of what is dead. Voided.com.